What if I told you that most organizations spend millions on firewalls but still get breached? Not because their firewalls are bad, but because they fundamentally misunderstand what firewalls do versus what intrusion detection and prevention systems do. A firewall is a gatekeeper, an IDS is a security camera, an IPS is a bouncer who physically stops threats. Three completely different jobs. Most companies deploy only one and wonder why attacks still succeed. Today, you learn the critical difference between detection and prevention. By the end, you'll understand exactly which tool stops which attack and why you need all three working together. Welcome back to Tech Sky. This is week 3 of Cyber Defense Mastery, and we need to address a dangerous misconception in cybersecurity. Many people think a firewall stops all attacks. It doesn't. A firewall controls what traffic is allowed to enter or leave your network based on rules. But once traffic passes those rules, the firewall stops caring what happens inside those connections. Think about airport security. The TSA checks your ticket and ID at the entrance. That's the firewall. But they don't follow you through the terminal monitoring your every action. If you do something suspicious after passing security, someone else needs to notice. That's where IDS comes in. And if you do something actively dangerous, someone needs to physically stop you. That's IPS. Three systems, three different roles. Let me show you exactly how each one works and when you need them. A firewall sits at the boundary of your network. It examines every packet trying to enter or leave and makes a simple decision. Allow or deny based on rules you define. The most basic firewall is stateless. It looks at each packet individually. Source address, destination address, service port, protocol. If a rule says to allow traffic from a specific source to a specific service, the firewall allows it. If no rule matches, it denies. Simple. But stateless firewalls have a problem. They don't understand context. Imagine this scenario. Your web server on port 80 needs to respond to client requests. With a stateless firewall, you need separate rules for incoming requests and outgoing responses. This becomes complex quickly. That's why modern firewalls are stateful. A stateful firewall tracks connections. When a client initiates a connection to your web server, the firewall remembers that connection exists. When the server responds, the firewall knows this is part of an existing conversation and allows it automatically. No need for separate return rules. Stateful firewalls also detect suspicious behavior like half-open connections. If someone tries to open thousands of connections but never completes the handshake, that's a SYN flood attack. A stateless firewall wouldn't notice. A stateful firewall sees the pattern and can block it. But here's what firewalls cannot do. They cannot inspect the contents of allowed traffic. If you allow HTTPS traffic on port 443, the firewall lets it through. But what if that encrypted connection belongs to an attacker downloading malware or exfiltrating data? The firewall doesn't know. The traffic matches a rule. It's allowed. This is where you need the next layer, detection. An intrusion detection system watches traffic that the firewall already allowed. Think of it as a security camera in a building. The camera doesn't stop people from entering. It records everything and alerts security when it sees suspicious behavior. IDS operates in two modes, signature-based and anomaly-based. Signature-based IDS works like antivirus. It has a database of known attack patterns, SQL injection attempts, buffer overflow exploits, malware command and control traffic. When the IDS sees traffic matching a known signature, it generates an alert. The advantage is high accuracy. If you see a pattern that matches the Emotet malware signature, you know with confidence that's Emotet. The disadvantage is it only catches known attacks. A brand new exploit with no signature? The IDS misses it completely. That's where anomaly-based IDS comes in. Instead of looking for known bad patterns, it learns what normal traffic looks like for your network. Average packet sizes, typical protocols, expected traffic volumes. When something deviates significantly from normal, it alerts. The advantage is catching unknown attacks. If an attacker uses a zero-day exploit you've never seen before, signature-based IDS misses it. But if that exploit generates unusual network traffic patterns, anomaly-based IDS flags it. The disadvantage is false positives. Maybe your finance team downloads a large data set for analysis. That's legitimate work but looks anomalous. The IDS alerts, you investigate. It's nothing. This happens frequently with anomaly-based detection. But here's the critical limitation of all IDS systems. They only detect an alert. They do not stop attacks. If your IDS sees an exploit attempt, it sends an alert to your SOC team. But that exploit packet still reaches the target system. Whether the system is vulnerable is a different question. But the IDS itself didn't prevent anything. It just raised awareness. This brings us to the final layer, prevention. An intrusion prevention system is an IDS with blocking capability. Instead of sitting off to the side watching copies of network traffic, an IPS sits in line. All traffic must flow through it. When it sees an attack, it doesn't just alert, it drops the malicious packets before they reach the target. This is powerful. An attacker scans your network for vulnerabilities. Your IDS sees it and alerts, but the scan completes. The attacker now knows which systems are vulnerable. With an IPS, the scan packets are dropped. The attacker gets no response. They learn nothing. The attack fails at reconnaissance, but inline blocking introduces risk. What if the IPS makes a mistake? What if it identifies legitimate traffic as malicious and blocks it? Your accounting software stops working because the IPS thought a database query looked like SQL injection. Your business operations break. This is why IPS deployment requires careful tuning. You start in detection-only mode. Run the IPS like an IDS. Let it alert on attacks, but don't block anything yet. Monitor the alerts for weeks. Identify false positives. Tune rules. Whitelist legitimate traffic that triggers false alerts. Only after you're confident the IPS understands your normal traffic do you enable blocking. Even then, you might block only high-confidence signatures. Critical alerts go to auto-block. Medium-confidence alerts still just notify your SOC team for human decision-making. The other consideration is performance. An IPS sits in line. Every packet must be inspected before forwarding. In high-speed networks processing gigabits per second, this adds latency. You need powerful hardware to run IPS without becoming a bottleneck. Despite these challenges, IPS is essential. Detection without prevention means you're always reacting to attacks that already succeeded. Prevention means stopping attacks before they cause damage. The industry evolved. Instead of deploying separate firewalls, IDS, and IPS as three different boxes, vendors combine them into next-generation firewalls, or NGFWs. An NGFW includes traditional firewall rules, but it also performs deep packet inspection. It can identify applications regardless of port. If someone tries to run BitTorrent over port 443 to bypass the firewall, a traditional firewall sees the port and allows it, but an NGFW recognizes the protocol and blocks it. NGFWs integrate IPS functionality. They run thousands of threat signatures in real time. They can decrypt SSL traffic to inspect encrypted connections for malware. They integrate with threat intelligence feeds to block known malicious IPs automatically. Some NGFWs even include sandboxing. When they see a suspicious file download, they don't just check signatures. They send the file to a virtual sandbox environment. Execute it. Watch what it does. If it behaves maliciously, block it and alert, all automatically. This is the future of network security. Defense in depth. Multiple detection and prevention layers working together. Here's the key principle. You need all of these working together. Your firewall blocks obviously bad traffic, connections from blacklisted countries, traffic to ports you don't use. This stops the crudest attacks. Your IDS watches allowed traffic for suspicious patterns. It catches attacks that bypass firewall rules because they use allowed ports and protocols. This gives your SOC team visibility. Your IPS blocks confirm threats in line. It stops exploit attempts, malware downloads, and command and control traffic before they complete. This prevents damage. Each layer catches what the previous layer missed. An attacker might bypass your firewall by using HTTPs on port 443. Your IDS detects the malware signature in the encrypted traffic. Your IPS blocks it before it reaches the endpoint. Or an attacker uses a zero-day exploit with no signature. Your firewall and IPS miss it because they don't know what to look for. But your anomaly-based IDS sees unusual outbound traffic patterns after the exploit succeeds. You detect the breach. You contain it. You prevent data exfiltration even though the initial exploit succeeded. This is why mature security programs deploy all three. Firewall for basic filtering, IDS for detection and alerting, IPS for active prevention. Together, they create overlapping defensive layers where a failure in one layer doesn't mean total compromise. Next video, you deploy pfSense, an enterprise-grade open-source firewall. You'll configure firewall rules, enable geo-blocking, and deploy Suricata in IPS mode for inline threat blocking. You're going to take the Suricata IDS you built in week 2 and upgrade it to IPS. Detection becomes prevention. Alerts become blocks. Your network defense evolves from passive monitoring to active protection. In the comments, tell me what security layer you find most interesting. Are you a firewall person who loves rule crafting, an IDS analyst who hunts through alerts, or an IPS operator who wants to stop attacks cold? Your answer tells me a lot about what kind of SOC role suits you. This is Tech Sky. Understanding the difference between detection and prevention is the difference between reactive security and proactive defense. See you in the next video.